Tonight's exploration is accompanied by Full Geek Brew Lab's Void Stout. Ooh, stare into the void. They describe it as having a balanced yet complex flavor profile ranging from roast to smoke with notes of chocolate. That sounds like something right up my alley. All right, old timers, is this sound traumatic for your memories? It certainly is for me. Which means I shall take the battery out of this thing so that it won't make that horrible noise again. This is a pocket pager, specifically a Motorola Bravo Classic model. Before cell phones were ubiquitous, these things were all the rage for people who really needed to be got in touch with. Repair technicians, such as myself included, although typically they would have originally been used by, you know, doctors and firefighters and that type of person. Yeah, but at the end of their reign of terror, they were basically being used just by drug dealers who didn't want to be tracked by their cell phones. Anyway, so this basically is a one-way communication device. Transmits from a tower to it. It receives a short text message, and then you go and find a payphone to call back whoever sent you the message. And when I say short message, I mean it. This thing can store up to 16 messages for a total of 160 characters. So basically 16 10-character messages. That's nothing for anybody who is used to, you know, SMS or texting these days, but this was state of the art back then. Back then being like the 1990s, and they kept going for a few years after this until, you know, SMS started existing on cell phones and there was no real reason for this kind of a device anymore. But some places kept using them for quite some time. The military specifically used them because, again, they wouldn't transmit, so they could be used within secure spaces. And I'm sure doctors kept using them because there was still quite a lot of time when you could not use a radio transmitter or a cell phone inside a hospital. Anyways, I'm not going to be using this thing because the transmitters that used to talk to this thing no longer exist. I've purely got it here as a teardown, which might just be a little bit cathartic because I want this thing to die. Anyway, the back comes off, as you see, with two screws and reveals a battery compartment, a LCD screen, and two circuit boards. And then how is that held in there? Or is it simply, it's just wedged in there. Fine, be like that. What do we got in there? A whole bunch of patents. Right. Freeze frame if you care to look them up. Interesting manufacturing note. It's actually got brass inserts in here for the machine screws to go into. Not unlike the heatset inserts that we use these days in 3D printing. So the two boards are just plugged together like that. That's cool and maintainable. What do we see? It looks like one board, the one in my left hand here, is the RF board. And the one in my right hand is a digital board. Because back in the day, Motorola was a huge manufacturer of chips and stuff, they of course used their own chips inside this thing. And I'm going to guess that this little microcontroller, because what else would it be, is going to be something completely proprietary, so I'm not even going to bother looking it up. That is probably going to be a little tiny bit of memory. A real tiny bit. Remember, this thing didn't have very much. And I think you can see the shiny conformal coating on there to keep it all nice and dry. These things would, of course, be subject to all kinds of abuse out in the world. They got dropped. They got rained on. All kinds of things. So that makes sense. This is interesting. This is the crystal clocking reference, which has got a little rubbery silicone bit over it to protect it. And of course, it doesn't say the frequency on it. It's just got a part number, which is no doubt going to be a Motorola proprietary number. That's going to be a theme in this thing, I'm sure. But what other obvious parts do we have? Well, we have the little vibrating motor here, which Is it just clipped on? How are you held there? Oh, the clip is soldered down. Okay. Anyway, it is just a motor, a little tiny DC motor with this offset weight. When it spins, it just kind of shakes the whole thing around. Over here, we have the little beeper, buzzer, noisemaker thing. I was sort of expecting this LCD screen to be on zebra stripes or zebra stripes, but no, it's got a little ribbon cable in there. That's kind of cool. And then, oh, see this guy here and this guy here, I believe that is the backlights for it, or side lights. They just kind of tuck in there and light it up. That's kind of nifty. Obviously non-replaceable. They look incandescent. They don't look like custom LEDs. Yeah, that's exactly what they are. Little incandescent lamps. So not a lot to see on that digital board. And I guess that doesn't really surprise me. It's just based on a little custom micro there from back in the 90s. Even though the manual was from 1995, these chips both have a 1990 date on them, as does that one on the other side of the board. So that dates this guy pretty clearly. Meanwhile, over here on the RF board. So this unit was, you get these in a lot of different frequency ranges. This particular one received on 931.9375 megahertz. A lot of them were in the 450 range, but this particular one, the company that was using it, had licenses up in the 900s, so that's where this thing operated at. Looks like this is the antenna. That's my guess here. A classic tunable inductor. So basically there's, inside that can, there's all the coils of the inductor, and then down in the middle, it's kind of hard to see, but there is a ferrite slug that screws in and out to vary the inductance of that. So that would be how you fine-tune the thing a little bit. A couple of variable capacitors there and there that serve the same purpose. This looks more like a crystal, and so does this. Let me just get those covers off them. What do we have? That one says 45.0. So that's probably generating an IF, an intermediate frequency, I'm thinking. And this other one, not sure if that is a part number or a frequency. I don't think that's a frequency. Without having a service manual for this thing, it's going to be almost impossible to figure out what's really happening in here. Oh, and then there's a third crystal over here. Again, that looks more like a part number than an actual frequency. Normally you'd expect the frequency to be embossed on the end of the can or something, but again, since Motorola is or was such a huge RF company, it made sense for them to do a lot of custom components or ordering stuff with internal part numbers on it so that you couldn't source them to repair it. Still, that is a very classic little RF circuit. This huge ground plane on the backside for shielding, that's very typical. There's the adjustable capacitors, 1, 2, and 3 there. 1, 2, and 3 on this side. Cool. And there's a hole here for the for adjusting the slug of that inductor. So you'd be able to tune the entire thing from this side, which makes sense because you'd want to tune it while it was in place in the package. You wouldn't want to have to yoink it out unceremoniously like I did. And yeah, pretty much every radio circuit back then did need some amount of fine tuning, at least from the factory, if not for service or repair later on. But as time went on, the RF circuitry got more and more integrated, less discrete like this one is, and much, much more stable. Digitally controlled phase lock loops, all kinds of good stuff like that that everybody is more familiar with these days. So I think I am going to try and salvage this vibrating motor because that's a fun thing to have. Other than that, though, I don't see any reason for this thing to continue existing. I'm happy for another one of these bastards to end its existence. They were the source of a lot of sleepless nights for me over many, many years. What else can I do with it? Maybe I'll take the buzzer out of it. Maybe I'll try and salvage these nifty little lights. Actually, let's try and power one on, just for the fun of it. So I got 1.5 volts on my power supply here, because I'm going to guess that's what those lights are. Dab those onto there. Yeah, there is the little light. So there's one there, and one there that act as backlights. Then there's a third one here, which I didn't point out earlier, which shone through this little translucent panel on there to indicate to you that you actually had a message. And it would blink every once in a while if you hadn't acknowledged the message using one of the two buttons on there. Kind of, I mean, it's neat enough technology, even though I found the application very annoying and interrupted my sleep a lot. But it's neat to see this old stuff from back in the earlier days, the simpler days when we didn't have smartphones that could do bi-directional text messaging, video messaging, video calling, and, you know, surf the web or watch silly YouTube videos of guys tearing apart old crap. Well, I hope you found that somewhat interesting, a bit of a trip down memory lane. Not too traumatic for those of you who had to live with one of these things beside your bed for years at a time. Thanks for watching, as always. Questions and comments and memories down below. I'll talk to you later.